Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus by Ludwig Wittgenstein, narrated by Griffin Chase.
Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus by Ludwig Wittgenstein, translated by C.K. Ogden. Introduction by Bertrand Russell. Mr. Wittgenstein's Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, whether or not it proved to give the ultimate truth on the matters with which it deals, certainly deserves, by its breadth and scope and profundity, to be considered an important event in the philosophical world. Starting from the principles of symbolism and the relations which are necessary between words and things in any language, it applies the result of this inquiry to various departments of traditional philosophy, showing in each case how traditional philosophy and traditional solutions arise out of ignorance of the principles of symbolism and out of misuse of language. The logical structure of propositions and the nature of logical inference are first dealt with. Thence we pass successively to theory of knowledge, principles of physics, ethics, and finally the mystical, das Mystische. In order to understand Mr. Wittgenstein's book, it is necessary to realize what is the problem with which he is concerned. In the part of his theory which deals with symbolism, he is concerned with the conditions which would have to be fulfilled by a logically perfect language. There are various problems as regards language. First, there is the problem what actually occurs in our minds when we use language, with the intention of meaning something by it. This problem belongs to psychology. Secondly, there is the problem as to what is the relation subsisting between thoughts, words, or sentences, and that which they refer to or mean. This problem belongs to epistemology. Thirdly, there is the problem of using sentences so as to convey truth rather than falsehood. This belongs to the special sciences dealing with the subject matter of the sentences in question. Fourthly, there is the question, what relation must one fact, such as a sentence, have to another in order to be capable of being a symbol for that other? This last is a logical question and is the one with which Mr. Wittgenstein is concerned. He is concerned with the conditions for accurate symbolism, i.e., for symbolism in which a sentence means something quite definite. In practice, language is always more or less vague, so that what we assert is never quite precise. Thus, logic has two problems to deal with in regard to symbolism. One, the conditions for sense rather than nonsense in combinations of symbols. Two, the conditions for uniqueness of meaning or reference in symbols or combinations of symbols. A logically perfect language has rules of syntax which prevent nonsense, and has single symbols which always have a definite and unique meaning. Mr. Wittgenstein is concerned with the conditions for a logically perfect language. Not that any language is logically perfect, or that we believe ourselves capable, here and now, of constructing a logically perfect language, but that the whole function of language is to have meaning, and it only fulfills this function in proportion as it approaches the ideal language to which we postulate. The essential business of language is to assert or deny facts. Given the syntax of language, the meaning of a sentence is determined as soon as the meaning of the component words is known. In order that a certain sentence should assert a certain fact, there must, however the language may be constructed, be something in common between the structure of the sentence and the structure of the fact. This is perhaps the most fundamental thesis of Mr. Wittgenstein's theory. That which has to be in common between the sentence and the fact cannot, he contends, be itself in turn said in language. It can, in his phraseology, only be shown, not said, for whatever we may say will still need to have the same structure. The first requisite of an ideal language would be that there should be one name for every simple, and never the same name for two different simples. A name is a simple symbol in the sense that it has no parts which are themselves symbols. In a logically perfect language, nothing that is not simple will have a simple symbol. The symbol for the whole will be a complex containing the symbols for the parts. In speaking of a complex, we are, as will later appear, sinning against the rules of philosophical grammar, but this is unavoidable at the outset. Quote, most propositions and questions that have been written about philosophical matters are not false but senseless. We cannot, therefore, answer questions of this kind at all but only state their senselessness. Most questions and propositions of the philosophers result from the fact that we do not understand the logic of our language. They are of the same kind as the question whether the good is more or less identical than the beautiful. 4.003. What is complex in the world is a fact. Facts which are not compounded of other facts are what Mr. Wittgenstein calls Sachverhalt. Whereas a fact which may consist of two or more facts is a Tatsache. Thus, for example, Socrates is wise is a Sachverhalt, as well as a Tatsache. Whereas Socrates is wise and Plato is his pupil is a Tatsache, but not a Sachverhalt. He compares linguistic expression to a projection in geometry. A geometrical figure may be projected in many ways. Each of these ways corresponds to a different language. But the projective properties of the original figure remain unchanged whichever of these ways may be adopted. These projective properties correspond to that which, in his theory, the proposition and the fact must have in common, if the proposition is to assert the fact. In certain elementary ways, this is, of course, obvious. It is impossible, for example, to make a statement about two men, assuming for the moment that the men may be treated as simples, without employing two names. And if you are going to assert a relation between the two men, it will be necessary that the sentence in which you make the assertion shall establish a relation between the two names. If we say Plato loves Socrates, the word loves, which occurs between the word Plato and the word Socrates, establishes a certain relation between these two words, and it is owing to this fact that our sentence is able to assert a relation between the persons named by the words Plato and Socrates. Quote, we must not say the complex sign ARB says that A stands in a certain relation R to B, but we must say that A stands in a certain relation to B says that ARB. 3.1432. Mr. Wittgenstein begins his theory of symbolism with the statement, 2.1, we make to ourselves pictures of facts. A picture, he says, is a model of the reality, and to the objects in the reality correspond the elements of the picture. The picture itself is a fact. The fact that things have a certain relation to each other is represented by the fact that in the picture, its elements have a certain relation to one another. Quote, in the picture and the pictured, there must be something identical in order that the one can be a picture of the other at all. What the picture must have in common with reality in order to be able to represent it after its manner, rightly or falsely, is its form of representation. 2.161, 2.17. We speak of a logical picture of a reality when we wish to imply only so much resemblance as is essential to its being a picture in any sense. That is to say, when we wish to imply no more than identity of logical form. The logical picture of a fact, he says, is a Gedanke. A picture can correspond or not correspond with the fact and be accordingly true or false. But in both cases, it shares the logical form with the fact. The sense in which he speaks of pictures is illustrated by his statement, quote, the gramophone record, the musical thought, the score, the waves of sound, all stand to one another in that pictorial internal relation which holds between language and the world. To all of them, the logical structure is common, like the two views, their two horses, and their lilies in the story. They are all, in a certain sense, one. 4.014. The possibility of a proposition representing a fact rests upon the fact that in it objects are represented by signs. The so-called logical constants are not represented by signs, but are themselves present in the proposition as in the fact. The proposition and the fact must exhibit the same logical manifold. And this cannot be itself represented, since it has to be in common between the fact and the picture. Mr. Wittgenstein maintains that everything properly philosophical belongs to what can only be shown, or to what is in common between a fact and its logical picture. It results from this view that nothing correct can be said in philosophy. Every philosophical proposition is bad grammar, and the best that we can hope to achieve by philosophical discussion is to lead people to see that philosophical discussion is a mistake. Quote, philosophy is not one of the natural sciences. The word philosophy must mean something which stands above or below, but not beside, the natural sciences. The object of philosophy is the logical clarification of thoughts. Philosophy is not a theory, but an activity. A philosophical work consists essentially of elucidations. The result of philosophy is not a number of philosophical propositions, but to make propositions clear. Philosophy should make clear and delimit sharply the thoughts which otherwise are, as it were, opaque and blurred. 4.111 and 4.112. In accordance with this principle, the things that have to be said in leading the reader to understand Mr. Wittgenstein's theory are all of them things which that theory itself condemns as meaningless. With this proviso, we will endeavor to convey the picture of the world which seems to underlie his system. The world consists of facts. Facts cannot, strictly speaking, be defined, but we can explain what we mean by saying that facts are what makes propositions true or false. Facts may contain parts which are facts, or may contain no such parts. For example, Socrates was a wise Athenian consists of two facts. Socrates was wise, and Socrates was an Athenian. A fact which has no parts that are facts is called by Mr. Wittgenstein a Sachverhalt. This is the same thing that he calls an atomic fact. An atomic fact, although it contains no parts that are facts, nevertheless does contain parts. If we may regard Socrates as wise as an atomic fact, we perceive that it contains the constituents Socrates and wise. If an atomic fact is analyzed as fully as possible, theoretical, not practical possibility is meant, the constituents finally reached may be called simples or objects. It is not contended by Wittgenstein that we can actually isolate the simple or have empirical knowledge of it. It is a logical necessity demanded by the theory, like an electron. His ground for maintaining that there must be simples is that every complex presupposes a fact. It is not necessarily assumed that the complexity of facts is finite. Even if every fact consisted of an infinite number of atomic facts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.